Welcome to GoTezu's chat room, co-sponsored by AdvoTalks and Splendid Pride. Today we have a legal tech expert, Mr. Robert Hanna. He is amongst the UK's top-rated legal recruiter. He's a legal influencer, as well he has an amazing podcast known as Legally Speaking. Welcome, Robert.
Well, thank you so much for having me. It's a real honor and pleasure to be on your show. I'm super excited to be here. I love all the work that you're doing, and I can't wait to get into our conversation today.
Yeah, great. So, Robert, I'll be asking you certain small and as well as quick questions about your journey, how you started and land up into being a good legal influencer. So please let me know the audience is seeking your knowledge.
Yes, so as you very kindly mentioned in your introduction, I'm a legal recruiter, and that's transitioned into legal recruiting, but also legal content creation and trying to educate, entertain, and inspire the whole global legal community. But I really started life as a recruiter in 2008. And I think it's really important to say it was really hard because I started in the 2008 Lehman Brothers crash, the financial crash. So I was very fortunate enough to have kept my job in 2008. And I learned in a FTSE 250 global environment and the real mechanics of what makes a good recruiter in terms of building relationships, consulting, more than just having a transactional relationship. And then from there, I moved to a boutique organization. I helped scale that particular business. And then in 2016, I had the exciting and honor of setting up my own business, KC Partners. And so why did I set up my own business and how did I get there? My grandfather ran a very successful law firm in the United Kingdom during the 1950s. And where I'm from, Leicester, that was the second richest city in the UK outside of London back in the day. And so I always wanted to have my time of sort of knowing and having some way of breaking into the legal industry and keeping that family legacy.
Great. So it's an honor to be connecting with you, but letting your portfolio, the most important thing that we came into a conclusion is branding. You brand yourself. So can you guide the audience that how you can brand your personality? How can you brand your profile, your CV to be a successful lawyer or for being hired by a successful law firm?
And it's so important nowadays. Having a personal brand is really crucial to career success in any profession, not just legal, might be accounting, might be insurance. And there's a few things you need to think about. Firstly, your personal brand is you. It's not perfect brand. So people are looking for authenticity in terms of your content. You don't have to be the lawyer that knows absolutely everything. You don't need to be the full marks law student. People want to relate with your stories. They want to learn with the authenticity behind who you are as an individual. Now, you always want to lead with a sense of value when you're building a personal brand. So a great way to do that is through storytelling and educating. One of the big ways to build community, which is something I think we should all be doing as part of our personal brands, is thinking about a topic of influence. So as you build a personal brand, so as you very kindly mentioned, I've got a lot of legal content creation. And so as a result of that, you know, branded as a legal influencer. But what I'm doing with my content is I'm providing a sense of hope for people looking to pursue a career in the law. So my topic of influence is careers. That's the broad topic. And then my vertical market is legal. So what I would suggest is when you're starting a personal brand and producing content, think about the pain point your audience is going through and serve them with valuable content. So as you also very kindly mentioned, I host the Legally Speaking podcast, which is in the top 1.5% of podcasts globally across 3,000 cities. We've had celebrities, we've had legal thought leaders. But what we aim to do with that is prize out the nuggets of wisdom from those particular guests to share with our community who might be having struggles with qualifying, getting a training contract, getting some legal work experience, maybe getting a promotion from associate to senior associate, maybe trying to be a partner within an organization, maybe looking to do career pivot from legal into legal tech, whatever it might be. So as part of your personal brand, always try to lead with value, educate, and provide high quality content. And people will resonate with that. But just remember to be yourself because no one else can be you. And that will really resonate with your audience.
That's perfectly fine, Robert. But I want to know top three secrets from Mr. Robert that a young lawyer should know that every big top law firm is seeking for. So any top three secrets which you need to showcase to the audience, to the public?
I think there's a few things you need to focus on. One, you have to be consistent when it comes to building your personal brand. I think that is an absolute must. You need to have consistency. Number two is you need to be an O-shaped lawyer. So what do I mean by that? So the O-shaped lawyer is removing the T-shaped lawyer, the more traditional T horizontal and vertical skill set. So with the O-shape, they're looking for people who can take ownership. Okay. They're looking for people who are opportunistic. So a little bit more entrepreneurial, how you could bring in clients to a law firm. They're looking for people who could think outside of the box. So look to be an O-shaped thinker. And that's what's going to differentiate you from the various other people out there. Because a lot of people have degrees, a lot of people have some work experience, but if you can showcase that O-shaped lawyer, that's important. And the third secret, do not give up. When it gets hard, do not give up. Trust me, if you want something in life bad enough, do not give up. Failure is only feedback. You know, do not give up. I see so many people trying to break into the legal profession that get a few rejections. Rejection is just redirection. Use that feedback, get mentors, bring people into your network that can help you. Have people that can inspire you and around you. But please, please, please do not give up on your dreams just because you have a few knockbacks. That is one of the biggest tips and takeaways I can give to anyone listening to this message right now. If it's meant to be, it's up to me, and it will happen if you do not give up.
That's fantastic advice, Robert. Now, talking about that, you have a forte for the legal tech, and as you can see that around the globe there has been a boom of startups coming up, and especially in the domain of legal. So what is your take into it? What are the challenges? What are the way forward? How can we see the coming decade for the legal tech industry?
I think it's a very exciting time for the legal tech industry. You're seeing a lot of these document automation platforms coming out. You're seeing how AI, I'm a big advocate of legal tech is good for the legal industry. And one of the overarching reasons why I think it's good is it's going to improve overall well-being and mental health of the lawyers. What I mean by that, this is going to be able to remove a lot of the work that, you know, lawyers have to spend late nights in the office going through due diligence, doing certain tasks. And so we need to improve the overall well-being and support lawyers so they don't get burnt out. The statistics of people leaving within 5 years within the legal profession is far too high. People's mental health, anxiety, stress, depression, missing holidays, missing family moments. Legal tech is to improve efficiencies within law firms to benefit, to ensure that we can provide a better, faster, quality solution to our clients, but also look after our people so our people can actually practice the law and why they wanted to get in the law, from that advisory, intellectual thinking, you know, all of those other things that make up the legal profession, rather than doing a lot of the kind of tough hours late into the night. So I'm a big advocate for legal help at legal tech, not only to benefit the end user, increase efficiency, but to help the people and improve the overall culture and less stress within these law firms.
You are absolutely right that a technology can eventually help an individual to grow, and that helps a society at the longer perspective. Robert, the scenario talking about in India, there are lots of startups coming up. We, with the GoTezu, we have partnered with the legal tech. It's known as AdvoTalk. We are penetrating because, you know, the population over here in India is big. There's lots of judicial pendency which is going on. So what are your advice to the startups coming up in India and the litigation scenario around the globe? And how can a technology can be a revolution in the coming decades?
Yeah, so there's a few things I would suggest. Firstly, make sure that your technology you are producing or developing, there's a real pain point for that. You need to stress but that there is a need, you know, because you can't just generate another docu automation platform. There's already those that are out there. What makes yours different? Or how does yours perform better? So really do some stress testing and some straw polling, do some focus groups, actually reach out to people, get your pilot product out in front of people, let them try it for free, give people free trials and get that feedback and really absorb those focus group feedbacks. I think the other thing is niche down. don't try to take a broad product, like as an extension of that, make sure your product works, but really have a niche within legal tech. Like you would within the legal industry, you don't just have a lawyer for everything. You have a corporate lawyer, you have a finance lawyer, you have a real estate lawyer. Legal tech is going to be broken down into subsets of niches, that some that we don't even know yet.
Yeah.
So the nicher you can go with your product, the better the pain point you can provide that solution, the far better it is. And if you're looking to try and scale that business, you need to have commercial people around you that have got experience of scaling businesses, raising funds, whether it's VC, whether it's angel investors. You need to have those skill sets for how you do that. And you need to know, have people, because great people, great inventors are great inventors. Great lawyers are great lawyers, but sometimes they're great in their areas, and you need people that are also great at running businesses. Some people can definitely do that, but there are very different skill sets between being a great inventor, being a great lawyer, to actually running a business, making it profitable, understanding how you can get that operationally efficiently, because the lifeblood to any business is lead flow. We yeah. all need clients. We all need lead flow. We all need a way where we can generate revenue. And so don't focus too much on trying to be the absolute perfect product and take no action. Because remember this quote, you know, done is better than perfect, because perfect never gets done. Done is better than perfect, because perfect never gets done. So whilst I'm saying you want to niche down your product, get it right, but stress test it, get that first pilot out, get the feedback, keep working on it, tweaking it, improving it, because you'd rather take imperfect action than rather perfect inaction. So it's really, really important to get off the action. You just got to get out there and do it.
Really appreciate your words. Now, taking this conversation forward, this is a looking at your profile that you are a mental health expert. So, talking about this area, about your journey, how you got into it, and what's your own personal journey of being a mental health expert, and how you have influenced people, and because it is a very big problem around the globe.
Yeah, so I probably describe myself as a mental health champion, because I've had family members that unfortunately have been affected through mental health, and we've lost family members through mental health. And myself and everyone in this world has a mental health. We all do. And, you know, some days I struggle with depression. Some days I struggle with anxiety. I think it's important, because people can see things on social media and they can see how things are great and these big brands and all of these followers and all of this content. But at the end of the day, we're all humans, and yeah. we all have emotions, and we all have feelings, and we're all going to have good days, bad days. But having the right people around you to support you is so important, and people that are genuinely there for you. But I'm a big advocate for saying be open and be around places where people, there's safe spaces for you to air, because a problem shared is a problem halved. So if you can just have people around you that can really open up to you, to say, look, I don't feel great today. And this is where law firms need to do more, from a well-being and support and safe spaces, and to really not stigmatize mental health. I actually don't like the term mental health. I would just like to call it health. Okay. Because we all have a health. There's no difference if you break your arm to whether you have anxiety. It's your overall health at the end of the day. And I think if we just remove mental health and just said we all have one health, health is wealth, and we just included that in the conversation, that would be so, so powerful. My overall dream is to have mental health gyms on the high street.
That's
because we have physical dream gyms on the high street. Why can't we have health dreams, gyms, and actual, you know, where it's normal, it's okay to have bad days and to actually go somewhere and have the support and feel safe and get better, or have the therapy or whatever it would be. So that's really what I would say. But I would strongly urge you to have people and be part of the societies and communities that can support you, because you don't have to be alone. I think a large part of mental health, people go inside, they isolate, they bottle up, and that's where things get worse and worse and worse.
So adding to these questions, Robert, what do you do to rejuvenate yourself? What do you do to rejuvenate your mind and to be active?
Yeah, I practice gratitude is a great thing, because I'm very aware that I have a home, I have a family, I have my, you know, I have my physical health. You know, I have a lot of things to be grateful for. And I think sometimes we put this extra stress and pressure on us and don't realize actually we're in a far better fortunate position than a lot of other people in the world. So I definitely practice gratitude. I take walks, I exercise, I get outside, I speak to friends and family that I trust. You know, I go to sleep, I go and sleep it off. I put myself first. And I think that's something you cannot be afraid of doing. because at the end of the day, we can't pour from empty cups. You can't service your clients if you're not servicing yourself. So it's so important that this is not just a nice to have. If you don't feel up to the job, you need to take the time to put it better for yourself. So sometimes I'll take 2 hours off and just go for a long walk. Great. And I think that's okay. I think it's really important that we do that.
Well, yeah. But adding to this, the work-life balance is an essential backbone for everyone. So talking about the young lawyer, let's take a scenario that a young lawyer in a law school is pursuing his law. So what are the characteristics he needs to keep in mind? So after pursuing his law, he can be hired by among the top rated law firms around the globe. So what are your suggestions to the young lawyers who are studying still in college?
Yeah, I would say do more. It's not enough just to have a degree, because everyone's going to have a degree. Okay. So some experience is better than no experience. Get work experience. If it's within a law firm, great. But if it's in another environment, look at the transferable skills and how that'll be applicable to actually a legal degree. So think about other skill sets that you could use, like time management, you know, whatever it would be. So getting experience on top of your degree is super important. Networking skills. Your net worth is your network, okay? So the better your network, the more opportunities will come your way. We talked a bit about earlier personal brand, getting yourself out there, building community. If you have a large network, more opportunities will come your way. You'll hear of more things. You'll get more opportunities. Get a mentor early. So if you're a law student and you're just learning out of the textbook, that's great. We've talked about getting the work experience, but then actually get somebody who can help mentor you, who's been there, done that along the journey you're trying to achieve, because they can give you the real world insights. They can prepare you for what you need to know. They can tell you what you need to know from a technical skill set point of view. And I say this time and time again, and this would make me a trillionaire if I could find the product to bottle it up and sell it. Work on your confidence.
Definitely.
You're invincible if you have confidence in whatever you do in any career, whether it's a lawyer, whether it's trying to be a prime minister, whether it's trying to be the next CEO, the next Elon Musk. If you have the internal belief and confidence, you can go so, so far. So I really encourage you to do work on your confidence. What I mean by that, maybe do some public speaking, be part of a debating group, apply to be a head of a society. Do things that put you out of your comfort zone, but grow you in confidence, because you'll become a far greater applicant because you bring more to the party. Maybe launch a podcast, go on podcasts, put yourself out of your comfort zone, and that'll pack your CV with all those other things I said that'll make you stand out and be a far greater asset to any law firm.
That's so great of you. And I'm very much confident that every individual who is listening to your thought process will be an enriched human being over the period of time. And eventually, I will recommend to go to your podcast. We will be sharing the links, as well as we'll be taking certain personal guidance to grow our own individuality. Robert, it was great interacting with you. Any final words? In a quick nutshell, you want to give to the youth, to the young lawyers, or any person?
Yeah, there's two things I say. If you don't risk anything, you risk everything.
Okay.
Really important to think about that. You know, you have to take some elements of risk throughout your career. Apply to that particular job, you know, do something that puts you out of your comfort zone. And then remember this, run your own race at your own pace. Everyone has their own journey. So just because someone's got that legal contract, just because someone's got that work experience, it just might not be your time yet. So run your own race at your own pace and don't give up. And I guarantee you it will happen for you. But it's been an absolute honor, pleasure being part of your show. It's been a real, real delight. I hope your listeners get value from this, but thank you so much for having me. Really, really enjoyed it.
Thank you, Robert. It's a privilege, a humble privilege talking to you. Thank you.